Good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2021. We've received apologies from Oliver Mundell, and we welcome back to our committee Megan Gallagher, who's joining us as one of our substitute members. We've also had apologies from Willie Rennie, who's not with us this morning. The first item on our agenda today is to take evidence on subordinate legislation SSI 2021-379, Protection of Vulnerable Groups Scotland Act 2007, applications for removal from list and late representations amendment regulations 2021. A motion to annul this instrument has been lodged by Oliver Mundell, and the motion will be moved by Megan Gallagher. As is the usual practice in such circumstances, we will have a brief evidence session, first with the Minister for Children and Young People, who has joined us this morning, which will allow members to ask questions and seek clarification. So may I give a warm welcome to Claire Hawkey, who is the Minister for Children and Young People. Good morning, Minister.
Good morning, Kim.
And the Minister is accompanied by Lynn McMinn, who is the Director of Policy, Customer Engagement and Communications Disclosure Scotland, and Rachel McLean, Disclosure Scotland Act Implementation Manager, Disclosure Scotland, and Rosie McQueen, Solicitor.
Denise Mackay. Rosie's not here this morning.
Okay, so Denise, good morning and welcome.
Good morning.
You're also a solicitor.
That's correct.
For the Scottish Government.
Correct.
Legal Directorate. We got that bit right. But it's good to see you here with us this morning. I invite the Minister to make some short opening remarks. Minister.
Convener, thank you for inviting me to speak to the Protection of Vulnerable Groups Scotland Act 2007, applications for removal from list and late representations amendment regulations 2021. I will not go into the technical detail of what the regulations do, because that's already explained in the accompanying documents produced by Scottish Government officials and is complemented by the Spice paper. I will say that the PVG Act has always included provision to allow barred individuals to make an application to be removed from the barred lists. Removal is contingent on ministers being satisfied that the applicant is no longer unsuitable to work with vulnerable groups. To be absolutely clear, the policy proposal allows people aged 18 to 25 to apply to be removed from the barred list sooner, but such an application does not lead to automatic removal. There is a thorough and well-established process for considering removal applications, one that replicates the process for inclusion in the barred list, carried out by Disclosure Scotland's Protection Services. The proposal in these regulations is also consistent with the situation in the rest of the United Kingdom, where individuals are able to ask for a review of a barring decision by the Disclosure and Barring Service. The system of state disclosure that we have today is in direct response to the tragic Soham murders of August 2002, and this government will never forget why this service is so important. Indeed, my predecessor brought forward the bill that became the Disclosure Scotland Act 2020 and will, once fully implemented, deliver a range of reforms to the Protecting Vulnerable Groups scheme that strengthen the National Barring Service. This government is committed to giving everyone a better chance to overcome early adversities, including youth offending, in order to allow them to become productive and valued citizens in adulthood. Our policy proposal in these regulations is in keeping with the wider reforms achieved by the Disclosure Scotland Act 2020, striking a balance between safeguarding and proportionality by enabling people with offending in their past to move on, where safeguarding considerations allow, into employment, work or volunteering. Disclosure Scotland has been engaging with relevant academics and experts in the formulation of policy supporting this measure. There is a clear association between age and desistance from crime, and the evidence supports that this should be recognised in policy. However, in every case, it is right that the individual circumstances are considered in order to make a safe decision about whether it is right to remove a person from the barred list. We know from the responses to the 2018 consultation on the protection of vulnerable groups and the disclosure of criminal information that there is stakeholder support for the changes made by these amendment regulations. particularly for the benefit they will provide care-experienced individuals who are more likely than their peers to have experiences with the criminal justice system. Who Cares Scotland said in their published consultation response that can be viewed on the Citizen Space website that they welcomed this change and said it's motivated by an understanding that those who commit crimes at a younger age are often trying to move on when coming into contact with PVG processes. I invite Ms Gallagher, on behalf of Mr Mundell, to withdraw his motion to annul. And if the motion is pressed, I would ask members not to vote in favour of it.
Thank you, Minister. I'm now going to turn to colleagues. I think we'll start with actually Megan Gallagher, whose name was just mentioned, who may have some questions for you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. Minister, if I could ask you firstly, please, if you could outline the justification of amending the legislation, in particular, where did the five-year limit originate from?
So, thank Ms Gallagher for our question. The regulations that we're discussing today will amend the prescribed period that must pass before a person has the right to make an application, and it will increase the age threshold for what is referred to in the principal regulations as the shortened prescribed period from under the age of 18 to the age of 25 and under. And that means that an individual included in the barred list, where their age between 18 and 25, will be able to make an application to be removed after 5 years have passed from the date of inclusion rather than 10. And again, I want to make it absolutely clear that these regulations do not automatically lead to individuals being removed from the barred list. They simply amend the circumstances in which an application for removal is competent. And as I said in my opening remarks, that the proposed changes are consistent with the situation in the rest of the United Kingdom, where individuals are able to ask for a review of the decision by of disclosure and the barring service there.
But why 25? Why not 24 or 26? So why is it 25?
Thank you. So the threshold is consistent with the situation in the rest of the UK, where individuals are able to ask for that change at the age of 25. It also is in line with corporate parenting responsibilities as they apply under the Children and Young People Scotland Act of 2014, where we acknowledge in Scotland that parenting does not stop at the age of 18. So that was the reason why that age in particular was chosen.
Right, I'm still not clear though, if I'm honest with you, Minister, because I hear what you're saying about the rest of the United Kingdom, but of course we have a devolution settlement. We can be different in Scotland, and quite rightly so on many occasions. Why was the age of 25 chosen? Why specifically 25? I'm not sure I heard an answer to that.
Can I bring in Lynn Mann?
Of course.
Lynn Mann.
Hi. To answer Ms Gallagher's question, the 5 years are already in statute. So when we did our pre-engagement and our early engagement with stakeholders and then during the consultation, there was no consensus to change from the 5 years and 10 years that's already prescribed in legislation. So there was no, we felt there was no need to change those that are already set in the current regulations. We also feel that 5 years and 10 years is provides the right balance between proportionality and safeguarding. With regards to the why we picked 25, there's a number of reasons. During the consultation, we actually provided a number of age points between 18 and 25. The majority of the responses to that consultation favoured an increase in that age, and the majority of those in favour of an increase in age were in favour of the 25. As Ms Haughey said, there's policy around, there's legislation where we already have the 26 or 25-year-old threshold. It meets our corporate parenting statute. The Children and Young People's Act recognised that care experienced people will need access to services till 26 because of their life experiences. They don't have the support systems that their peers would have. They're also more likely to interact with the justice system, unlike their peers at that age. It's also, as Ms Haughey said, in line with the rest of the UK. And I think that's that. Okay.
Thanks, Convener. If I could move on just briefly, would the introduction of these regulations make it easier and more accessible for people between the ages of 18 and 25 that are identified as harmful towards children be allowed to work with vulnerable groups sooner? Is there a risk there?
We all have a responsibility to ensure that children and young people and vulnerable adults are safeguarded. As I'd said again in my opening remarks, the process that someone would have to go through to have that barring lifted is the same process as when that barring is imposed. So there are robust processes round about this. We want to ensure that we protect children and young people and vulnerable people. And what this does, or what these changes in regulations does, is recognises that for offences of or people placed on the banning list under the age of 25, that there has to be some change there and some recognition that young people move on from lifestyle choices and behaviours that have been harmful in the past. And I don't know if perhaps some of in terms of the actual legalities of it, if perhaps Denise or Lynn want to come in terms of the actual process that someone would go through.
Just to emphasise, no, it won't make it easier. Under the current regulations, anybody over the age of 18 can wait 10 years to make an application to be removed from the bar list, or it can be sooner than 10 years if they can independently evidence that there's been a change to their circumstances that led to the barring in the first place. As Ms Haughey said, the process to be removed is as robust as the process to be added to the barring list. The protection unit would... an application for removal does not necessarily mean that you will be automatically removed. There is a robust process. Our caseworkers have the same information power and gathering powers that they have under the current system and the system to be added to the barred list. So it goes through a process of evidence-based process to make a determination on an individual case-by-case situation. And I can say that in the last 11 years we've had 17 applications for removal. 19 applications for removal, and 13 have been successful. And of those successful applications, 2 have been under the age of 26.
Ms Gallagher, I'm going to ask Michael to come in at this point. He wants to ask a supplementary to something you've raised.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, the robust process has been mentioned a few times. Could you say a little bit more about what the mentioned evidence gathering, what that entails, so we can have some confidence in it?
Yeah, there's a process, a caseworking process done by a protection unit. They follow guidance in a casework manual which was developed and co-produced in 2014 with clinical psychologists. It's peer-reviewed by other psychologists. It went to a committee of experts, academics, psychologists, care workers and unions. There's a decision-making process. Not one individual makes a decision. It goes through a triage, so each case is looked at by multiple people before a decision is taken. Information is gathered from courts, court service, police, Police Scotland. They can get information from social work, educators. They can get specific reports around risk assessment. They can get specific clinical psychological reports. The information gathering powers are wide and allows them to gather whatever information they feel necessary to make a decision.
Okay, that's helpful. Thanks, Cindy.
Do you want to come back in?
Please, Convener, just briefly again on what we're talking about there about people being able to work with vulnerable groups sooner. When we're looking at the victims that have had these crimes committed against them, how do you think they would feel if someone was able to go through this system, be approved and be allowed to work with vulnerable groups more sooner? Because I think there is a risk that the legislation could favour the perpetrator over the victim in this instance.
Sorry. Obviously we recognise that the victims of crime have to be respected and have to feel that they receive appropriate supports regardless of the punishment or otherwise of the person who perpetrated that. It's worth recognising that the group of people that this change in regulation will affect will have been young people, there is a robust process round about looking at whether they should be removed from a barred list, as you've heard from Lynn about the process that people go through. So we can be assured that if they are removed from the barred list, then they're suitable to be able to work with groups that they had previously been barred from. I don't think any of us would wish anyone that we didn't feel was suitable to be able to work with children, young people and vulnerable adults.
Thank you. I've got one last question, convener, but happy for...
Yeah, yes. Let me bring... Please, yes.
Thanks very
Deputy
much.
Convener.
I just wanted to ask about sort of the right to rehabilitation, and if you could just sort of like explain a little bit about where that rationale comes from and how that has been supported through evidence from Who Cares Scotland, for example, or other agencies that have been part of this.
Well, I think it's really important to acknowledge that there was wide consultation when this legislation was proposed and going through Parliament. And I mentioned in my opening remarks about Who Cares Scotland and the support that they gave to that. But there were also other supporting voices, such as Recruit with Conviction. There was a joint response from the Centre for Youth and Criminal Justice and Improving Life Chances Implementation Group, who also expressed their support for increasing the age threshold to the highest age offered. So there certainly is widespread support from stakeholders in making this change in regulation.
Okay. James Dornan.
Convener, I wonder if the Minister could give a wee bit of information around automatic listing, what it exactly entails and what sort of percentage of people are on it and how many have ever been taken off it.
Lynn, are you able to give Mr Dornan a bit more information on the process round about automatic listing?
Yeah, there's a series of serious offences that are set out in statute that we refer to as automatic listing offences, and if you're convicted of one of those offences, there are offences such as murder of a child, rape, etc., you're automatically listed. If you just give me a moment, I'll try and find the stats, but I can tell you that we have never removed anybody from the barred list who's been automatically listed. I think they make up about 26% of the over 8,000 barred people in Scotland, but I can't.
And I think to add to that, I know that anyone who is convicted as being mentally ill and lacking a capacity at the time of the conviction would also automatically be added to that list.
Okay, thanks very much for that.
James, perhaps in the spirit of continuing this, putting on the record, the circumstances of people appear, their names appear on this barred list. Can you just tell us on what basis people, other than the automatic measurement, which we've just heard about, what are the other circumstances in which people are on this list specifically?
Yeah, absolutely. Lynn, do you want to?
Absolutely. There's obviously other offending behaviour can result in you being considered for listed and then after an investigation being put on the list. So there's also the proximity of that behaviour to the regulated work that you might be doing. There's also referrals from employers, so you may be working in regulated work and behaved in a manner that was not appropriate or deemed appropriate, and they can refer you to putting a referral disclosure Scotland, where again an investigation would take place and then you could be listed you can be listed not necessarily by being convicted of a crime. You can also, Police Scotland can also push in other relevant information which isn't, might be information about somebody's conduct that could also result in you being considered for listing and then possibly after investigation put on the barred list. It's not just criminal convictions that could result in you being barred.
It's a situation where an individual has in the course of doing work, regulated work, has harmed a child, placed a child at risk of harm, engaged in inappropriate conduct involving pornography, engaged in inappropriate conduct of a sexual nature involving a child or a protected adult, or has given inappropriate medical treatment to a child or a protected adult. That's how people end up on the list. So when we speak about a change in circumstances, what does that mean? How do you define a change in circumstances when people, I mean, this is pretty serious. Pretty serious, whether you're 16, 24, 34, this is a serious misdemeanour.
I mean, not everybody who's on the list will have committed those offences. It could be that you've committed a series of offending over a period. It could be theft, for example, and you want to go and work in a care home. And because you've offended in the proximity to and how close that offending is to you actually wanting to do that work, that could be taken into factor. So not everything is those serious offences, as you said. Changing circumstances could be that you've been convicted of an offence, appealed it and it was quashed. It could be that the behaviour that led to you being barred was the direct result of, say, addiction to alcohol or drugs, and then you can evidence sometime down the line that you've actually sought treatment, that the behaviour's desisted and, you know, and it's no longer behaviour that is of concern. But like I said, just because, again, you put in an application because you claim that your circumstances have changed, it will still go through a thorough investigation before consideration is given to whether or not you should be removed off the list. And
currently, if someone was convicted of an offence that put them onto the barred list, and then that conviction was overturned, are you saying they'd still have to wait 10 years currently before they're...
No, they can put in a... Because they can show that
they can do that now.
Yeah, they can show so, that they're...
So there's no need to change to 5 years in those circumstances you've just described. An overturned conviction would take them off the list anyway.
No, you don't. As I said earlier...
It's a separate issue.
Yeah, as I said earlier, there's
separate from the legislation that we're considering now.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fair enough. So in terms of the process answer that you gave to Michael Mara earlier, does, and I should really be directing this to the Minister, I do apologise, it's the Minister that I know that's the lead person here. Who handles this process? It's Disclosure Scotland, is it?
There's a protection unit within Disclosure Scotland, which was set up in 2011.
Yeah.
And they do the work on behalf of ministers, and they do the work to determine whether or not somebody should be added to the list, and they do the work to determine whether or not somebody should be removed from the list.
And then they recommend something to the ministers? They make a recommendation to the ministers?
You make decisions. Occasionally, that depending on the circumstances, it might be that it goes to the minister, but generally we...
It's done in the name of the ministers,
though. It's not done on behalf of Scottish ministers.
Yeah, you acting on behalf of the ministers. Right, with you. Okay. Fergus Ewing.
To ask for clarification of the Minister and her officials, two questions, fairly simple questions. First of all, is it right that before any individual is removed from the barred list, there is and must be and will continue to be a full and robust consideration of whether that person remains unsuitable, and moreover, that this regulation won't change that? So there is at the moment a robust test of detailed, careful consideration, and that will remain the case if these regulations are passed. That was the first question.
Yes, I can confirm that.
And the second question, thank you, Minister, and the second question is, Is it the case that what we are doing here will, in effect, bring Scotland into line with England, and that will see the same hurdles and time provisions apply?
Yes, I can confirm that too. Yep.
Thank you, Minister.
It's not essential, of course, that we're in line with England.
But I think it gives some context round about...
It seems rather strange conversation, doesn't it, in a political context?
I guess it just gives some context round about the changes and that we're not doing something that
because
is...
Because it's being done in other parts of the United Kingdom.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's not a good reason to change anything in Scots law. Yeah.
Consistency across the borders is helpful because if you're barred in Scotland, you're barred in the rest of the UK, and therefore if you're removed from the barred list, you could well be removed from the rest of the UK if you're barred in, if the barring service in England and Wales deems you unsuitable because you've applied there, then you're barred in Scotland and elsewhere in the UK as well, just for clarification.
Right, okay. I think we've probably... I'm looking for any other questions. I don't think there are any other questions. I think we've given a fair airing and appreciate the candour and willingness that we have seen from the Minister and her colleagues in answering our questions. So at this point, I want us to move, unless anyone objects, on to our next agenda item today, which is consideration of motion S6M 02353, which is asking the committee to agree to recommend that SSI 2021-379, Protection of Vulnerable Groups, Scotland Act 2007, applications for removal from list and late representations, Amendment Regulations 2021, be annulled. I would like to ask Megan Gallagher to speak to and move the motion. Am I required to repeat all of that again? as previously mentioned, so Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Convener. I speak to move the motion on behalf of Oliver Mundell that the Education, Children and Young People Committee recommends that the Protection of Vulnerable Groups, Scotland Act 2007, applications for the removal from list and late representations amendment be annulled. Currently, those aged 18 to 25 who wish to apply to be removed from the children's or adults list, as set out in the Protection of Vulnerable Groups Act, can apply to do so after 10 years. Individuals on the children's adult list are on there because it has been decided by ministers that it would be inappropriate for that individual to work with children or vulnerable adults. Reasons for referral can include in engaging in child sex offences, amongst other things. The SSI would lower the threshold from 5 years for 18 to 25-year-olds, meaning that they can apply to be removed from the children's adult list 5 years after being placed on there. This is concerning as it may allow people who have been identified as harmful to children to be allowed to work with children sooner, as they could reoffend and they can reapply within the five-year limit instead of 10. This could also perhaps reduce confidence in the disclosure system if the individual who was on the children's adult list has been removed. There are also concerns relating to victims who will feel that the Scottish Government is perhaps favouring the perpetrator over them, and what happens, of course, if they are living within the same community. There could be wider issues within the community environment there too. In terms of the discussions that we've had this morning, the sort of offences in terms of cases are too wide. I think we, in terms of this legislation, perhaps, that would need to be looked into further in order for it to be approved. And also, there's other concerns as well relating to the issues that are raised in relation to the five-year limit and the overall justification of amending the legislation today. So moving the limit is a serious cause for concern and one that should not be taken for the reasons I've listed today and in terms of the outstanding concerns as well that has been raised by members. I therefore move the amendment in Oliver Mundell's name.
Thank you, Megan Gallagher. Do any other members have any comments on the motion? Looks like maybe not. Thank you, Megan, for your... James, I beg your pardon. James Dornan.
No, my fault, convener, I put my hand up too late. Can we just get it confirmed that this is not about letting somebody leave from being barred, but it only allows them to make an application? Because it does seem to be some confusion here. It's almost as if what we're saying is that after the 5 years, they would automatically be free from the bar that they already have.
Thank you for that comment. The Minister may address that remarks, which I'll invite her to do shortly. I think the issues that Megan Gallagher raised are certainly worthy of the airing that we've given them in this committee this morning. And if I may say, I think it's hard to understand exactly why at this particular point it's felt necessary to reduce the 10 years to 5 years, given the fact there are already flexibilities that were highlighted by Lynn McMinn in response to a question I asked about overturned convictions. And while it is true that there's a variety of convictions or behaviours that result on someone being on the barred list, that the list of those in the main who are on this list consists of people who have committed fairly serious indiscretions in relation to children and to vulnerable or protected adults. That, by the way, these are my comments as an individual member of the committee, not as the convener of the committee. I think I'm allowed to make my comments known without prejudicing the chair. And I will conclude my comments by inviting Ross Greer to make his.
Thanks, Convener. Just very briefly on the point of around the seriousness of offences that might result in an individual ending up on this list. I think it's fair to say that it would be very unlikely for an individual who's committed some of the really serious offences that we've talking about to actually be in a position that their application to be removed from the list would be granted. But some of the examples we've heard, for example, of an individual who might have committed theft and wishes to work in a care home, that's exactly the kind of circumstance that we talk about in the debates that we've had in this Parliament around the rehabilitation of offenders, acknowledging the adverse childhood experiences that some young people are affected by, the relationship this has with care-experienced young people. What we're not talking about here is a mechanism solely for allowing those who are guilty of the most serious offences to get themselves removed from this list. In all likelihood, those who would be able to make a successful application would not be those guilty of the serious offences that you've mentioned. It would be those who have done something that is of far, far less gravity. In fact, something that may indeed not be a criminal offence, but maybe something that resulted in them being placed on the list in the first place. So I think it's important to put that on the record. A lot of this debate has understandably focused about the minority of people who are on this list because they've committed a very serious offence. I think, in all likelihood, the application of the mechanism that would be allowed through this instrument is not—it's not going to be common for it to be applied in those cases. It's going to be much, much more common for it to be applied in cases of far less seriousness that fit absolutely into the category of the rehabilitation of offenders that we've discussed many times in this Parliament, and indeed that we passed legislation on in the last session, I believe, unanimously.
Thank you, Ross. Fergus Ewing, to be followed by Stephanie Gallagher. Gallagher? Callaghan, sorry. Getting my Gallaghers and my Callaghans mixed up. Fergus, carry on.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I would endorse what Ross Greer has just said and just add a couple of points to that. First of all, my understanding is from the response that the officials gave is that if these regulations are passed, then there will be no change at all to the test that is applied to continue to protect the public from those who have committed, as has been said, a more serious offence. There'll be no change at all. The only alteration is that people will be allowed to make an application at an earlier age. But if that is an application that would be refused, it would simply refuse when they're younger. So any suggestion that there's an increased risk seems to me to be nothing short of scaremongering, Convener. And I'm sure that nobody would wish to do that. And it's particularly disappointing to hear these kind of arguments when we've already heard that one of the benefits will be, and this is the other point I wanted to make, is that there will be consistency of approach throughout the UK. And that then means that those children in Scotland who may succeed in an application to move south and take up advantages there and vice versa So I think that should, may in fact have practical benefits benefits to be followed. For those reasons, I will be voting against the motion to annul. Thank you.
Yes, I hear what you're saying, Fergus. I think Stephanie, and apologies for getting your surname wrong. I'm getting.
Thank you, convener. I would agree with Ross and Fergus, and I would challenge your assertion as well around the fact that it's all serious offences. It's certainly not. For example, you have quite often young men who are unable to find a toilet after being out at a nightclub, and there can be indecent exposure offences, etc. around that. It's something that I've experienced as well in my work with young people. I think it's also important to keep in mind about keeping the promise, which is something that we have all really supported, and the fact that, care experienced young people are more likely to have that involvement with the law, as has been said earlier on there too. But you know, this is a key period for them as well. This 5-year period is a key time when they're actually looking at employment, further training, etc. And we have to give people really, you know, the opportunities to actually move on and to have success in life. Right now, they're not nearly as likely, statistically, to be successful, and we have to do all we can to support that without putting people at risk. There are proper safeguards in place. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie. On the issue of there being no risk, I'll ask the Minister to address that issue for the record, that there is no risk at all attached to this change in measure. Michael.
Thanks, Convener. Just to make my own comments on it, I came into the discussion and wanted to listen to the Minister and officials with a fairly open mind about this. And I think what I've heard is that there are strong safeguards and a robust process across agencies to make sure that this is the public can be protected in this regard. I think that the practical effect of this seems to me that we go through the same process, but in a timious manner that allows people to have a chance in their life if the process comes to a positive conclusion for them. I'm also satisfied that the numbers of those in the barred list that are making such applications are almost vanishingly small, and that they, within that there should be sufficient capacity to make sure that these processes are fairly robust. I've listened to the arguments and I'm convinced that this is a reasonable step with a robust process to protect the public.
Thank you, Michael. I just want to say to Fergus directly, I don't think it's fair to accuse a colleague of fear-mongering if they have genuine concerns about what a change in legislation might create in terms of increased risk, even for one person, who might then re-offend with disastrous results in the lives of others. I think it's rather unfair, actually, to accuse colleagues of that on the basis of legislative consideration. So now I now turn to the Minister, who I know is only too ready to respond to the points that have been made. Minister.
Thank you, Convener. And can I say that I've listened very carefully to the debate, and I am grateful for having had the opportunity to explain the Scottish Government's position with regards to this SSI. With regards to the point that Mr Dornan raised, and I think it is one worth reiterating, that I'm absolutely clear that these regulations do not automatically lead to individuals being removed from the barred list, and it simply amends the circumstances in which an application for removal is competent, in that it changes those timescales. As I said in my opening statement, I invite Ms Gallagher not to move Mr Mundell's motion. However, if pressed to a vote, I will ask members to vote in favour of passing the regulation.
Thank you, Minister. I will now invite Megan Gallagher to wind up.
Thanks, Convener. Not much more to add in terms of the debate today. However, I would like to just touch on two points that were made by colleagues. Just to reiterate the point of scaremongering, it absolutely is not the case. This is legitimate concerns. It is about weighing up risks. And I'm not convinced that this legislation would eliminate the risks that we've spoke about and we've raised today. In terms of all serious offences mentioned by Stephanie Callaghan, that's not what I said, and I think she's perhaps picked me up wrong. I said there was a wide-ranging list of offences, and I think that's where, again, another concern comes into it, because, yes, it could be something minimal. However, it could be something more serious, and it's weighing up, you know, what would be approved, what would not be approved, and I think that is something that we need to have more discussions over instead of approving the legislation as is. If I could touch on the barred list as well, I understand James Dornan's point. However, as we heard earlier, out of the 19 applications, 13 were successful. So that shows that there is a sort of sway in terms of applications being approved, and that's okay if they have went through the robust processes. However, it does add in that further element of risk. So they're the points that I'd like to add to the debate now, convener, and I'll finish there.
Thank you, Megan Gallagher. The question is that motion S6M 02353, in the name of Oliver Mundell, be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes, yeses and noes. So we are not agreed. As we're in a hybrid meeting, I would like to invite members who are attending virtually to vote via the chat function. Members who are in the committee room can vote by raising their hands. Please keep your hand raised while the clerks record your vote. Can I ask members in favour of the motion and attending remotely to put yes in the chat box now, and members who are present in the room to raise their hand? Can I ask members who are voting against the motion and attending remotely to put no in the chat box, and members who are present in the room to raise their hand? Can I ask any members who wish to abstain and are attending remotely to put abstain in the chat box now, and members who are present in the room to raise their hand? But everyone has voted, so we are clear on that. All members have now voted. The results are as follows. The results of the vote are 2 in favour, 7 against, no abstentions. The motion is therefore disagreed. The committee must now produce a report on this draft instrument. Is the committee content to delegate responsibility to the deputy convener and I to agree this report on behalf of the committee? This will be a brief factual report with a link to today's official report. Are we agreed? We are agreed. I would like to thank the minister and officials for their time this morning. We will have a 2-minute suspension to allow the witnesses to leave. Thank you very much. Welcome back. Our next agenda item is consideration of SSI 2021-380, Disclosure Scotland Act 2020, Commencement No. 1 and Transitory Provision Regulations 2021. Can I just pause there for a moment? I don't see any colleagues on screen. Are they with us? Are they there? I think they are. Yes, they are. Let me resume. Our next agenda item, colleagues, is consideration of SSI 2021-380, Disclosure Scotland Act 2020, Commencement No. 1 and Transitory Provision Regulations 2021. Do members have any comments? Don't see anyone indicating they wish to comment. So is the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instrument? Are we agreed? We are agreed. Thank you. Our next agenda item for business, is that we will be taking evidence on skills alignment with business needs. And to that end, I'd like to welcome to the committee Leon Thompson, Executive Director of Scotland UK Hospitality. Leon, welcome. And Paul Mitchell, who's Head of Employment Affairs, the Scottish Building Federation. Welcome, Paul. And we've got an opportunity now to ask questions of Leon and Paul. And to that end, I would like to invite Fergus to begin the questions. Fergus Ewing.
Yes, thank you, Convener, and good morning to the witnesses, and thank you for joining us today. These written submissions, Convener, that we've had indicate quite rightly that business wishes, in order to help us achieve economic recovery following the effects of the pandemic, to focus on areas where there has been a special damage. And I think tourism and retail have been mentioned, although there are others. And I agree with that, and I welcome that. And Leon Thompson, in particular, will be aware of the work of the Tourism Task Force that was completed, which looked at some quite specific measures, I think involving particular universities and colleges and establishments that have a very distinguished track record, for example, in tourism. I was also slightly concerned to see in the evidence from our retail colleagues that the number of apprentices in retail has reduced over recent years. I guess what I would like the witnesses to focus on really in supplementing their written submissions, Convener, is to provide us with as specific as possible a prognosis, a set of measures that they would wish to see in place, rather than generally saying you should do more. What in particular should that more be, and who should provide it? And I appreciate that these are complex matters, Convener, acutely aware of that, having been in a driving seat of sorts as a minister for 14 years, and how difficult it is to deliver objectives into reality. But I think some very positive, specific, prescriptive suggestions about how in particular we help younger people and how money should be focused on those areas, such as tourism and retail, would be very welcome. And the question is to both witnesses. Thank you.
Leon, would you like to go first?
Yes, Convener, I'm very happy to do that. And thank you very much for inviting me along today. In response to the question from Mr. Ewing, I mean, I think I'd start off by saying that hospitality works very closely with education providers, also with Scottish and UK governments as well, and we take very much a partnership approach to developing the workforce for hospitality. I mean, there are some great examples of where things are working well at the moment. We have some terrific colleges, delivering outstanding courses and bringing young workers through into the sector. We have businesses working with those colleges and education providers providing pathways and routes into work. We're working very closely with UK government around Kickstart as well, which a number of our members are making very good use of that, and with the Scottish Government around the Young Persons Guarantee as well. So there's a lot of initiatives which are already there, which are working well and are delivering for hospitality, albeit with the disruption caused by the pandemic, they're still very much in the foreground. So we do have good partnership working. We do have strong connections there. We are, as a sector, offering some great jobs, some terrific careers for our young people to take up. I think perhaps where we've got a real hurdle is still sort of challenging some of the perceptions around jobs and careers in hospitality. And that's something that I think collectively we can look at addressing, really beginning to talk up those roles in hospitality and more widely in tourism as well, and getting schools, parents on side with talking to their young people about careers in hospitality. And we worked very closely with the Scottish Government immediately after the reopening of hospitality earlier this year, and the Scottish Government put £100,000 into a promotion campaign to encourage young people to consider jobs and careers in the sector. And that's certainly something that we'd like to see more of in the future as well, because again, that sort of demonstrates some very good partnership working between the sector and government.
Fergus?
Yes, thank you. And I'm aware of lots of good work, convener, that's done by Visit Scotland, by Kickstart, by colleges and universities throughout the country. So I won't name them; it would take too long. But there's much good work done, and also by industry itself. And industry has partnered with the public sector in many ways to help young people into tourism, and also to give specific work experience to youngsters whilst they may pursue primarily an academic classroom-based training course or certificate or indeed degree of some sort, also to provide that practical experience. And I think industry is to be congratulated for that. I would be grateful if Leon, the UK Hospitality Association, as well as bodies such as the Scottish Tourism Alliance, can continue the good relationship that they have with the public sector and the Government of Scotland to build on what happens, because I do think more does need to be done. And I do agree with the point that Leon makes, and this is the last thing I'll say, convener, before inviting other witnesses to respond, that there is still a perception risk, even although that tourism and hospitality and indeed food and drink and events offer terrific career opportunities and will do in the future as well as they did in the past. Thank you.
Yes, Paul Mitchell.
Thank you, convener, and good morning. We really do appreciate the opportunity to give evidence to the committee this morning. In answer to Fergus Ewan's question about what specific measures can we take at this moment in time, if we look firstly to the COVID recovery situation, we currently have in the construction industry a cohort of around 500 apprentices who should have completed their time served construction craft apprenticeships and biblical trades of joinery, bricklaying, painting in August and September of this year. And for a number of reasons, some of which are related to the coronavirus pandemic, some of which are related to the arrangements for the apprenticeship qualifications, those candidates haven't managed to finish their apprenticeships yet. Their futures are uncertain. It's causing a level of delay for employers as well. And we really need to look at measures to get this group of, as I say, 500 apprentices through their qualification as soon as possible. And with that in mind, some real consideration has to be given to allowing candidates to undertake simulation with a view to completing their portfolio of evidence. It's not always been possible to collect evidence from site during the pandemic, and the opportunity to allow simulation would really help these candidates, because they have now been delayed for a number of months and that uncertainty is ongoing. If I were to mention two other issues, the first of which would be reform of the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, which is derived from the apprenticeship levy contributions. We've seen earlier this year evidence that if financial incentives are provided to employers to recruit apprentices, apprenticeship recruitment increases. Of course, earlier this year we had the Apprenticeship Employer Grant, which provided £5,000 to employers to take on an apprentice, and construction apprentices went through the roof at that time. So I think creating some sort of hybrid model where the existing provision for college training and upskilling and retraining is retained, but also allowing some element of incentivising apprenticeship recruitment through the Flexible Workforce Development Fund. Perhaps that could be targeted in areas where there are known skill shortages or areas where there are underrepresented groups. But I think that would be a real step forward. And more broadly, my final contribution just now would be to say that I think taking measures to re-engage with industry, we feel very disenfranchised at this moment in time in relation to the skills planning landscape and development and arrangements for our apprenticeships. Re-establishing those connections with industry, perhaps through reinstating of apprenticeship registration bodies, which were organisations which consisted 50% of employer representatives and 50% of employee representatives would be a real step forward in that regard.
Thank you. I don't know if Fergus wants to come back in.
Well, just I think that both witnesses have provided some positive suggestions, and I think we should pursue these afterwards. So no doubt we can discuss that, convener. But I think we have got some pretty concrete pointers in the right direction. And I just wanted just perhaps to ask Paul one small supplementary question, if I may. Is there concern in the construction sector, Paul, that there is, generally speaking, a shortage of skilled labour in many of the particular trades that are essential to pursue construction projects? And would you agree with me, as someone who represents a largely rural constituency, that the shortage of available contractors means that it is very difficult to get competitive prices for projects, and that has led to price inflation in many projects, both in the public and private sector? And does finally, Paul, consider that as part of the solution to these issues, that we really do need to take up the suggestions that he makes in order to ensure that there's a larger stream of young people coming forward in rural and urban Scotland in the construction sector to carry out the work that we all believe is necessary for schools, roads, hospitals, railways, and private sector projects as well? Thank you.
And houses. Yeah, absolutely. Paul, do you want to come back on that supplementary from Fergus?
Yes, certainly. We do have skills shortages and issues at this moment in time, particularly in rural parts of Scotland. Bricklaying and labouring are two areas where I know our members are reporting difficulties. This does, of course, have some impact not only on project costs but on project timescales. There are other issues related to costings, and as I'm sure members would be aware, that there was material supply side issues earlier this year as we recovered from COVID, and that really pushed the cost of materials up. We are having to deal with that inflation on an ongoing basis. But I can advise that the latest study that was conducted in construction recommended that between 2020 and 2025, the construction industry in Scotland required over 26,000 new entrants to our industry. So there are fantastic opportunities within construction to build a career. we do need new entrants. But also I think it's worth pausing for a second to recognise that construction, even during 2020-2021, recruited 5,000 apprentices, still very much top of the class in terms of all the other sectors. That is something we are immensely proud of, not just the number of opportunities that have been created, but the depth and the scale of those apprenticeship offerings as well.
Thank you. If I can ask a question of Leon. You know, this impression that people have got, this perception that hospitality is largely about casual work. It's something that students do, or, you know, that kind of popular idea about employment in the sector that you represent is obviously, it kind of works against you, hospitality as a sector, doesn't it? I mean, so what has the sector done in order to try and change those sorts of perceptions and pitch itself to particularly younger people who perhaps don't see it currently as a skilled route to a career?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, the sector is very much on the front foot with this, and businesses are doing a lot of work with schools, going into schools, talking to young people at schools, you know, when they're considering their employment options after school education, and talking up the roles and opportunities which exist within
hospitality. Just a question on the comment about schools. Do you get into all schools? Because employers I speak to find that, yes, there are some really positive experiences engaging with schools, but there are also some where it's very hard to get through the front door.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. I mean, it's patching. I mean, in some areas, in some instances, it's working very well. In other instances, it's not working so well. I mean, it's very much kind of locally driven approach. And what we could really do with is actually sort of getting some consistency across the engagement that businesses can have with schools, so that they can actually set out the employment opportunities that are there.
Is it entirely at the discretion of the head teacher as to whether employers or any employers or some employers or, you know, get through the front door? Is it entirely a local head teacher decision?
Well, I mean, local in the sense of local authorities, but also schools as well will obviously have a say on how they engage with local businesses as well. So it's that lack of consistency which certainly hinders businesses perhaps taking a more proactive approach on this. But I mean, there are some excellent examples that already exist. So the template, if you like, the model for doing this very well is already there.
And in the broader pitching of the sector, as discussed, I mean, in terms of career structure, what has the sector been doing in order to, you know, sell this to younger people, to attract people into the sector?
Yep. So I mentioned the campaign, the social media campaign that was run in conjunction with the Scottish Government back in June. So that was very much sort of talking up all the different roles which exist within hospitality, because I think that's one of the key issues for the sector, is actually being able to unpack the variety of the roles which exist in hospitality. People will automatically think about front of house staff, they may think about chefs, but there's a whole range of roles and jobs available, and these can lead to very fulfilling and rewarding careers in within businesses and across the sector as a whole. A number of our members are actually they run their own promotional campaigns as well, encouraging people to apply for the roles that they have available. We have members who have set up their own hospitality academies as well. So that allows them to recruit and, crucially, to retain staff, particularly young people as well. So people join those businesses, and there are opportunities to expand and to learn more on the job, which again sort of, you know, highlights the very real career opportunities which exist within the sector.
Where would you describe you are on the journey from this perception level, low skill to higher skill, or the perception issue surrounding low pay to much better pay? I mean, where is the sector on that journey?
I think we're doing well. We're certainly moving forward. I mean, we have obviously had a setback with the pandemic, and we've got businesses still grappling with that at the moment. And the biggest challenge that businesses face just now is probably the issues around job security and hospitality. You know, hospitality being the first to close and last to reopen during the pandemic. So that's a big hindrance at the moment. I mean, what I would point to is that of those students who are currently studying hospitality-related courses, they're saying that they certainly intend to enter the sector once they've completed their courses. So that's incredibly encouraging. You know, there is that pipeline, and people are coming through. Young people are coming through into the sector. But there's more to be done, and the sector, as I mentioned, is working very closely with the government on this. The sector is also looking at running a national campaign as well at some point in the next year, which will actually highlight the diversity of the roles available to people entering hospitality. And I think that will be a really important initiative in sort of breaking down some of the perceptions which you know, wrongly still exist out there.
And you come the way this is coming across, Leon, is you seem to be saying, don't let me put words in your mouth, by the way, but you seem to be saying that the sector understands the ball is at its feet as much as that as at the feet of anyone else in terms of perception change and selling the reality of a really positive career in hospitality.
Yeah, I mean, that is absolutely correct. As I said at the start of the session, you know, partnership is absolutely key to what we do. I mean, here in Scotland, UK Hospitality Scotland works very closely with Skills Development Scotland, and obviously our partners in Scottish Tourism Alliance and the education providers as well. And it's very much a team effort to make the changes and to attract people into our important sector.
Michael Mara.
Thanks very much. And my first questions, I think, go to Leon regarding the skills gaps and the impact of the pandemic. I mean, I don't think it would be, plenty of us have seen signs up in whether it be pubs or cafe windows, you know, certainly looking for staff, and some shops saying, and pubs saying, they can't open because they don't have enough staff. I mean, do you feel that this is a short-term shock to our labour supply that's particularly acute? I mean, you've talked about the long-term working, and if we can leave that to the side for the moment, I think it's good to hear about the good partnership working across these different areas. But I'm particularly keen to see what we can do in the short term to try and help industry address those issues.
Well, the big challenge at the moment is that we just don't have enough people in Scotland of working age to fill the vacancies. I mean, with the economy having restarted, I mean, there's a huge imbalance in the demand for labour versus the number of jobs which are available and the labour supply which is there. So, I mean, we're experiencing, you know, severe disruption in the labour supply for hospitality at the moment. I mean, pre-pandemic, we were the third largest employer in Scotland, employing 285,000 people, you know, right around the country, you know, every corner of Scotland. You know, our members are saying at the moment that they're, you know, experiencing shortages of anywhere between sort of 10% and 16% in the number of workers that they need. So, businesses are, you know, looking at, you know, how they can manage with fewer workers. They're obviously bringing in people who don't have perhaps any experience in hospitality as well. So that's, you know, a good opportunity for people to come in and, you know, learn some new skills and get involved in a sector that they're perhaps not they're not familiar with. But the fundamental challenge remains that right now there just do not see, there seem to be more, there are more vacancies than there appear to be people available to work. So that's what businesses are grappling with just now. We mentioned obviously students coming through from colleges, but we've had disruption to that pipeline of talent as well, with many students repeating years because of problems in delivering courses through lockdown and so on. So we've also got that disruption as well. So there's a whole number of reasons as to why we're experiencing these problems, and on top of that as well, we obviously have the changes in the immigration system, which has compounded some of the challenges for some businesses as well. But businesses are doing what they do best. They're being adaptable. They're being resilient. They're looking at how they can increase productivity, with the number of workers that they have. But yes, as you pointed out, some businesses are having to reduce the service, reduce the hours that they're available to operate, and that's holding the sector back and moving forward with the recovery.
I find that really useful in terms of the trends that you're laying out there, Leon, for the sector. Don't feel to me to they may have emerged due to the kind of the rapid rebounding of the economy. I think that's taken most people globally by surprise. The scale of government investment to try and make sure that that's happened, I think, has been welcome. But the skills shortages you're illustrating, I think, are taking place in many countries around the world. I don't doubt that some of that has been exacerbated by the shape of our own labour market in regard to immigration as well. But this is something that's fairly common. So, I mean, do you believe as a result of that, and these are longer term changes about behaviour in both people and working patterns, consumers, do we need to then have some slightly more profound reset into how we address these issues? I mean, you've talked about the positive atmosphere in terms of working with agencies. That's great. Mm-hmm. Do we need to look at some of these issues more in a more concerted way to think about what is emerging as a new normal?
Yes, absolutely. We see that the sector will need to keep adapting. We'll need to continue to be presenting itself as an attractive place to work, for people to come in and work and to build their careers. And right now businesses have made a number of changes to make their offer more attractive and more appealing to young people coming in. So looking at more flexibility around hours, obviously pay is a key issue as well, and we're in a very competitive market for labour, so that's obviously driving up wages as well. So the majority of businesses will now be paying the real living wage, or if not above, in order to attract and retain its workers. So we're already seeing that rebalance going on, as essentially sort of market forces are dictating that businesses need to do that in order to recruit and retain their workforce.
My last point to you, I've been speaking to colleges in the last couple of weeks who are telling me that they are struggling to retain students due to the opportunities that emerge for well-paid jobs in your industry. So completing courses and making sure that they have the qualifications to hand to allow them to work through a longer term career, obviously there's a drive on your side of the fence to try and get people into work, and that's a great thing. Are you working with your members to ensure that their new recruits can complete those courses and get the credits and make sure they've got the credentials that can provide a longer term career?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I mean, our members are really very clear that they want to have skilled workers coming in, people who have completed courses, who have actually have their qualifications and so on. I mean, obviously it doesn't end there. On job training is absolutely critical, particularly in a sector like hospitality as well. So businesses are in this for the long term and are sort of looking at building talent within Scotland and making sure that we have that sort of constant flow of skilled young people coming into the sector, because that is very much where the future lies for our sector.
Last one, if I can, compare to the colleague from the Scottish Building Federation. I'm interested in issues pertaining to net zero and training of not just young people, which we've focused on principally, I think, so far in this discussion, but in terms of perhaps older, more experienced tradespeople and people who are bringing skills to the labour market. Do you think that there is enough being done both by the industry and by the associated agencies to support you to upskill and refresh the workforce so that we can meet that challenge in terms of higher building standards, different approaches, new technologies? Are we building capacity and are we reacting enough as institutions to help you do that work?
We are getting to take steps in the right direction there. I think, like many other sectors, COP had an impact on that. We do recognise that we have a problem within our sector in relation to continuous professional development. Often when the CAS people complete their apprenticeship, the only training that is after is in relation to health and safety. So that there has to be a culture change, there has to be a mindset change. We have looked at initiatives such as supporting tradespeople to be accredited to Passive House standard, and that is something that we are going to have to look at. There's also an opportunity going forward to look and review the apprenticeship qualifications through the new staff apprenticeship approval process, and that is an opportunity not only to look at embedding in the apprenticeships issues relating to net zero, but also to look at modern methods of instruction, building information technology, to make sure that our apprenticeships are modernised, are contemporary, and reflect what's actually happening outside, what the requirements of employers are in the sector.
Thanks, Paul. Thanks, Camille.
Thank you. Ross Greer.
Thank you, Convener. To start off, just on the point that Paul's mentioned there around apprenticeships, this might sound like a slightly daft question, so hear me out. Do we need to rebrand foundation apprenticeships? Because I've had a concern for a while that, for a start, if you're my age or older, the word foundation in education and skills terms is generally associated with the lowest of the three standard grade levels. But a foundation apprenticeship is actually a really attractive opportunity, and it's a substantial course and employment opportunity. My concern is that the brand that we've given it, from some of the feedback I've had from young people, it puts them off. It sounds as if it's something that they shouldn't consider because there are other opportunities that sound superficially more attractive. Do you think we've got the branding right around foundation apprenticeships?
Sorry, no, I don't think we've got the branding correct at all, and I would agree with those comments. When I was in school, foundation was the worst of the three standard grade levels as well. I don't think it sends out the right message to candidates and to employers, and I think it would benefit from change. Who knows, perhaps a pathways, apprenticeship, something of that nature, but I certainly think that the branding has to be looked at. And specifically in construction, there is a little bit of an issue with foundation apprenticeships, in so much as we do not want to kind of half train candidates in bricklaying or joinery in order that they can then go out into the market and start operating. There's no license or minimum requirement to operate as a craft person in Scotland. So we need to be careful that we're not giving somebody a little bit of knowledge that we actually train them to the correct level and make sure there's a coherent pathway from that foundation apprenticeship into a modern apprenticeship and you don't want to graduate apprenticeship.
Thanks very much. Moving on to another area. About 5 years ago, our predecessor committee did quite a wide-ranging inquiry into what we call personal social education in schools. And it touched on some of the kind of what you might call soft employability skills. It touched on questions around, are schools preparing young people in skills like CV drafting, preparation for interview, etc. Now, at that point, I think it was 5 years ago now. At that point, what we found was there was huge inconsistency across the country. Some schools were excellent at this. Young people were leaving at the end of fourth, fifth or sixth year, knowing how to draft their CV, knowing exactly how to prepare for and perform in an interview. And in other schools, that simply just wasn't part of their PSE curriculum at all. I'd be interested in both of your reflections on whether or not this has improved over the last 5 years. Are you getting the impression that young people are leaving school with these kind of employability skills, or is there still an inconsistency there? Maybe start with Leon on this one.
I think there's still a lack of consistency there. You know, certainly speaking to members in terms of the sort of applications that they get, I mean, it really is a very mixed picture. You know, some applications are very good, some are not so good. I mean, I think clearly skills have improved in this area. There's certainly a lot more kind of in the way of resources available for young people to access now, as well as support that they get at school around sort of applying for CV. Putting together CVs and preparing themselves for interview, but the picture is still very mixed and still quite patchy. I mean, right now, you know, applications are obviously coming through from people looking for work, which are perhaps, you know, on paper not particularly strong, but you know, because businesses are looking for workers, people are young people are getting those opportunities to come in for interview, which is probably incredibly helpful for them because they're getting some real life experience, sort of, you know, sitting down talking to an employer, which even if they're unsuccessful in securing a place, will help them in their endeavours in the future.
Yes, I would agree with Leon. There still is a level of inconsistency there. A lot of our members, our employers, when they're looking to recruit an apprentice, want some real core, basic, what might be referred to as meta skills. They want somebody who can turn up regularly, who's punctual, who has the right attitude, and they can then mould them into a CAF person for the future. I just wanted to turn quickly, if I can, to the conversation earlier around working schools and careers development. That work is always really, really important. As a federation, we have our local associations and we try and engage with schools through each of our local associations across Scotland. But to be candid with the committee, the problem for construction is not a lack of demand from candidates for construction apprenticeships. It's despite the high levels of apprenticeship offerings in construction, the problem is that we do not have sufficient levels of opportunity there. We need to make sure that we create the right conditions, the right environment to encourage employers to recruit apprentices. And this is where I have the real concern going forward. The lack of engagement with industry, the neutering, the marginalisation of the industry voice in the skills planning landscape has led to the introduction of changes which are really detrimental to employers and which then turn employers off the prospect of offering apprenticeship opportunities. If I can give you one example, and I'm happy to write to the committee to give several more examples, but one example from just this week, we have been told by Scottish Government and Skills Development Scotland that a candidate will not be considered to be an apprentice unless they are registered on SDSE's FIPS system. That does not reflect the recruitment practices within the Scottish construction industry, and it could really disadvantage some employers and some candidates. So to illustrate that with an example, if an employer recruited an apprentice in the start of the summer time, but perhaps they didn't get registered on FIPS until now, that period of months would not count towards the time served element of the apprenticeship and would have the effect of extending the apprenticeship time served period. That's not what employers want. It's not what trade unions want. It's not suiting the needs of employers and the apprentice. And there are several issues like that now tied up across the apprenticeship offering and construction, because that employer voice is not in the room. That industry voice, indeed, and the trade union colleagues as well, is not in the room when critical decisions are being made.
That's all from me, Commissioner, but I think Paul's last point there around the SDS apprenticeship registration system is probably one that we should write to the government about to ask for an explanation of the rationale behind it.
Yeah, that's a very important piece of evidence that Paul's just given. So thank you, Ross, for getting us to that bit of evidence. Michael Mara.
And also, if I may, I think the core to that point about the representation of business and employers in these groups appropriately should be included in that as well. I'm sure we'll touch on that later in our own discussion of the evidence. But yeah, I think that was particularly powerful evidence.
So thank you to colleagues for the question so far. I'd like to talk a bit more about apprenticeships, because I've got a bit of a thing about apprenticeships, because I, like Ross, believe that this is a fantastic thing that we should all be very committed to. Leon, most of your members, I presume, will be paying annual salary bill in excess of £3 million, are they? Many of them will be?
Yes, something in that order, yes.
So they're paying the apprenticeship levy?
That's right, yes.
Do they see it as good value for money?
It's certainly a lot of questions coming back from members as to, whether, they are actually sort of getting what they need from the apprenticeship levy, from the payments that they're making. And I think we would certainly sort of welcome a discussion with governments around the apprenticeship levy, and sort of how we actually sort of get it to work better for our businesses.
So that was a brilliant political answer, Leon. You have another career ahead of you based on that answer alone. Was that no? They don't think they're getting value for money?
certainly, some members I've spoken to certainly question whether they're getting.
Okay, let me ask the same set of questions to Paul. I think I've got a flavour of what Paul might say to these questions, but most of your members are certainly paying over £3 million a year in annual salary bill, and therefore they are also paying the apprenticeship levy, yes?
Yes, there are approximately about 100 employers in Scotland in the construction industry who are apprenticeship levy payers. However, the real problem that we have in construction is that we also have our own industry training levy.
You do, the Construction Industry Training Board. You also pay money to them as well, don't you?
That's correct. So many of our members are paying twice, once for the industry training levy and again for the apprenticeship levy. And I touched on the issues that we have with the apprenticeship levy.
Yeah.
And in Scotland.
So your answer to my second question really is do your members think they're getting value for money based on the fact that they are being double levied? I guess what is the answer? I better not lead the witness. What's your answer? Value for money?
Candidly, I think the answer to that would be no.
Be no. Okay, so going back to Leon, what would have to change in the way that this money is being spent in Scotland for your members to begin to believe, Leon, that they might be getting value for money? What would have to change? Give us the changes that you would like to see happen. Leon? I was beginning to think that my comment about another career in politics had put you off so much that you left the meeting.
Not at all. I'm not sure I've got enough detail on this to actually give you the answer that you're looking for just now. So, I'd be quite happy to come back with some further information. We can send that in writing. I think for our members, though, it's very much about looking at how there can be more flexibility built into the scheme. I think that's probably one of the key issues for them at the moment. And I think right now, businesses are probably more focused on the immediate needs of actually filling vacancies just now, rather than necessarily looking at what changes they need to the apprenticeship levy. But I'd be very happy to come back with some more detail on that.
Well, based on our earlier conversation, these things actually, I think, run together, don't they? To attract people into an industry, The idea of offering them the career prospect that comes with an apprenticeship would, I think, be a powerful incentive to take a second look at hospitality as a career. So I think that these things are very closely linked. I think we'd be very interested to know what specific policy changes members of UK hospitality would like to see in Scotland so that members felt that they were getting value for money with their apprenticeship levy. And I'm wondering whether or not they would like maybe, I set this before you as a kind of an enticing offer of a question, would they like to see more transparency and how their specific contributions are returned to them in terms of investing in their apprentices?
I think they would. You know, that would certainly, you know, enable them to, you know, understand, you know, what exactly they're getting in return for paying the levy.
Yeah, I think that's a pretty basic point. They would like to see what they get for the money they pay in. And currently, it's fair to say, is it not, that they cannot discern exactly what that money, where that money goes. Is that a correct statement on my part?
That is correct. It is very hard for them to really determine how that comes back in any kind of return.
So, Paul, Mitchell, you already began to give us an answer in response to Ross Greer's questions, but what other policy changes would your members like to see specifically around value for money apprenticeship levy? I mean, I think that everyone knows that you have to invest in people. I don't think there's a contention around that, but what would they like to see in policy changes that would reflect value for money for the apprenticeship levy?
Yes, so at the moment we have the situation where apprenticeship levy players can claim £15,000 through the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, and that can be used predominantly through their local college. There has been some changes recently to allow private training providers to get involved in that process if colleges don't offer that training. For example, training in the operation of plant machinery. Many local colleges won't offer that specific training, so private providers are needed. So I think looking again at the rules to allow private providers to get involved in the Flexible Workforce Development Fund. But as I say, at its core, we have an apprenticeship levy in Scotland that does not then go on to fund apprenticeship opportunities in Scotland. We looked at that apprenticeship employer grant from earlier this year. Had a massively positive effect in Scotland, and particularly within the construction industry. And if we could look at using some of that money, I realise it's not a bottomless pit, but if we could look at some of that money being allocated towards incentivising employers to recruit apprentices, I think that would be hugely beneficial, as well as retaining some of the elements about upskilling and retraining and allowing greater private involvement in that process.
Yeah, and to both Paul and you, Leon, we welcome any further evidence you wish to submit to us about specifics from your members in relation to this question that I'm asking at the minute, especially in terms of policy changes that would really generate value around this apprenticeship levy that your members are paying into. Colleges have been mentioned quite a few times this morning, and I'm certainly very aware, I'm sure my colleagues are as well, of the excellent work that's done in the college sector in support of apprenticeships. But the one area that I always have a concern about is how committed our universities are to supporting apprenticeships, because I have a question in my head about that, to be honest. What's your reflection on that, Leon? What's your engagement with universities as a sector like? Do you get much come back from the universities? What kind of things are you talking to them about, and what kinds of things are they doing for you?
Probably less engagement with universities than with colleges. I mean, obviously, universities are providing, you know, excellent courses, people coming through doing, you know, tourism events and hospitality related courses as well. So again, this will be one where there's probably quite a lot of engagement amongst member businesses directly with universities in their specific areas, where they're able to partner up and look at sort of work opportunities for students on those courses, and those students leaving those courses as well. But it's not a sector I have a lot of experience of engagement with.
Some of the evidence we've received, including evidence in connection with the next panel that we're about to meet, it talks about the importance to the to different sectors of graduate apprenticeships, where clearly university could play a very important part. In your sector, Leon, is there a demand for graduate apprentices?
Certainly a demand for graduates to come in and take roles in hospitality. I mean, there's certainly a lot of graduates will leave and will be, you know, moving into to start their careers within hospitality, and businesses will be working to offer the best opportunities.
What about undergraduates who are going to become graduate apprentices? I mean, you can do an apprenticeship without any direct connection with a higher educational partner. What I'm suggesting to you is there a demand in hospitality for the kind of relationship that I envisage that ought to exist between business and universities?
Absolutely. And yeah, as I say, I mean, there will be businesses who have already established those relationships with universities.
Can I ask the same questions to Paul? Do you have any comments on?
Yes, convener, I think I would really just echo Leon's comments there. Our relationships are probably closer with the college sector than the university sector. We do, of course, have graduate apprenticeship opportunities within the construction industry and things like construction management, surveying, estimating. And they have been a welcome addition. The numbers are growing steadily. It was only introduced, as you'll be aware, in recent years. So I think there is an opportunity for improvement there. But certainly, as things stand, our relationship's closer with the college sector.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you very much. I'm just looking. I think Stephanie would like to come in. Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, convener. I don't know if you can see me because I can't. All right, okay, there we go. It's a question for Paul. I'm actually lucky enough that after this meeting this morning, I'm heading over to Bells Hill to meet Dan McGee, the Managing Director at DMG Roofing. So they're opening up an Academy of Roofing, which I thought was a really, really interesting one. They've got an older workforce and looking to invest in younger people. And Dan did actually win Britain's Top Tradesperson as well. But I know he's doing some excellent work kind of promoting the value of apprenticeships, you know, having the qualifications and skills as a tradesperson there. So he's connected in with SDS and careers advisors for over 60 schools. He's also offering people's work experience tasters, which is something that really can capture young people's interest there. And it'll be, you know, bag of nails and materials. So the real McCoy, if you like, there to try and attract young people and bring them forward. So what I'm wondering, Paul, is what can the Scottish Government do to help support those kind of stronger links with school and education that really inspire our young people to consider skilled trades and a career that's full of opportunities for them? Thanks.
So, firstly, GMG are members of ours, so please do pass on my congratulations to Darren and to everybody concerned on the development of their apprenticeship academy. There is a lot of existing work at the minute in terms of going into schools. Some of that is coordinated through DYW. So, for example, there is a Build Your Future campaign, which is a collection of online videos and interactive activities that school pupils can undertake online. We do work closely with CITB to train employers to go into schools to deliver career sessions, activities, guidance, events. As I say, I don't want to focus on this issue too much, but I do feel that on balance, the issues that we have within construction are not a lack of demand from young people. Many youngsters still really value a construction apprenticeship. We undoubtedly have problems in relation to diversity, and there are sometimes issues with the standard of the candidates. It's also not a blanket picture across the whole of Scotland. There are those rural issues that, as well. But really for us, it is about ensuring that those apprenticeship conditions are right for the employer to encourage the employer to take these young people on. We have lots of young people who get involved in pre-vot qualifications, particularly the Professional Development Award in Scotland. In fact, there are more candidates doing pre-vot qualifications in construction crafts than there are opportunities each year offered to become an apprentice, which doesn't seem right to me and to the industry. And we need to look at these issues and try and unpick them. I do want to, again, take this opportunity to return to the theme of industry engagement. Again, this is an area where I think greater involvement with industry, with employers, federations, trade unions, apprentices, collectively to try and address this problem, because the same issues that we face at pre-vot level are faced at apprenticeship level, and it all stems from this lack of engagement with industry. We used to have in our sector the apprenticeship registration bodies, which provided a real platform for formal industry engagement. Very little could be done in relation to apprenticeships in Scotland without the express consent of the industry, and we certainly didn't face the issues that we did when we had that model in place that we are facing now. So perhaps if the convener would allow, I can write to the committee in a little bit more detail on that specific issue.
Yeah, that would be fabulous. Thank you, Paul. Leon?
Thank you.
Yes, I mean, you know, we've obviously talked a lot about schools and colleges and so on, and I mean, you know, that is obviously kind of an area that you know, we'll continue to keep working very closely with our members on to keep those channels of communication open and look at ways of developing new ones.
Thank you, Stephanie. Are you content at this point?
Yep, that's great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Paul and Leon.
Well, indeed, I echo what Stephanie just said. Thank you very much to Leon Thompson and Paul Mitchell. That does conclude our time with you today. It's been very, very valuable. Those offers that you've made of additional information and input to the committee are very warmly welcomed, and we look forward to receiving them. But can I thank you again and wish you a very pleasant day for the remainder of the day. Thank you. We will now suspend for a couple of minutes to allow for a change of witnesses. Welcome back, and welcome to all those on our second panel. And we have a very rich selection of people on the second panel. We've got Professor Mark Logan, Professor in Practice, School of Computing Science at Glasgow University. Dr. Natalie Cool, Head of Cybersecurity at the School of Design and Informatics at Abertay University. And Karen Meehan, who's Chief Executive Officer of Scotland IS. And Nicola Taylor, who is Head of Operations and Skills at Scotland IS. Thank you all for your time today. It is very much appreciated. We're going to go straight into the questioning with the Deputy Convener, Cocab Stewart.
Hi, good morning, everyone. I read the submission by Scotland IS, and in that I note that it says 80% of future jobs will require STEM skills, and then it goes on about the gender imbalance there. But I just wanted to sort of like then go on to the fact that it mentions about staffing and getting computer teachers, computer science or digital skills teachers. So I know, you know, as a practitioner in the field, that schools do a lot of good work on that already. So clearly, there seems to be something that's not transferring through. And I just wondered if you could shed any light on that, that could enable us to make recommendations on what could be done better. Can I put that question to Karen Meehan, please, first of all, and then if anyone else wants to chip in, that would be grand.
Hi, thank you for that. So some research done of the 356 local authority high schools, Education Scotland have done some research, and of the 301 who have come back to that, there are 36 of those schools who don't have a computing science teacher or function within that school, which means there are 36 schools who don't have access to the subject, or certainly enough access to the subject. And of those 36 schools, 18 of them are in remote or very remote areas. So we know that there's a lack in computing science teachers, and we know that we need, you know, there needs to be a way to have more into schools to allow our young people to access these skills and this knowledge. And, you know, there are a couple of things that industry are doing, a couple of things that our skills board are doing, looking at how do we create that pipeline of computing science teachers into our schools. And then we've got to balance that with the fact that we have a huge skills gap in the industry. So when we're looking at the graduates coming out of university and we're looking at the apprenticeships models, we're also looking at how do we backfill some of that skills gap. So it's a, I suppose it's a two-pronged issue that we have.
Thanks for that. I think sort of, you know, the Scottish Government has committed substantial sums of money to sort of teacher recruitment. So is it just a question of money, or is it something else? Why is it that people don't want to be, or, you know, there is a lack of? What is that?
Well, I think there's probably two parts. So obviously, you must want to be a teacher to teach. And some of the things that we've been looking at is in some of the medical degrees that you can undertake, you can take a year out to learn another degree. And a lot of that is being, you know, they're encouraged to do teaching. So for some of our graduates, they've not looked at teaching as a potential career path. So they haven't gone and sought that, you know, that experience or that pathway. And when we look at some of the medical profession, then, you know, we're looking at as a sector, is there something we can do with our graduates, give them access to that as a potential pathway? So, you know, we have computing science teachers who have done their undergrad, they've gone in, teaching's what they want to do, that's the topic they want to teach. But not everyone wants to, and not everyone knows if they want to because they haven't experienced it. So we need to find a way to, I suppose, open up the opportunity for those graduates in our computing science degrees throughout Scotland to look at, is teaching a potential career path for me now that I have the skills? And that's something, as I say, we're doing some research on with our Digital Skills Advisory Board on what does that look like? Is that an opportunity? We appreciate it would be an extra year onto an already four-year degree. And if it was to come back from universities and industry, that would be a good way forward. There would be a requirement for some kind of funding through Scottish Government through to continue that extra year of education within our higher education institution.
Thanks, Karen. Can I bring in Professor Mark Logan on this, please?
I think we have the subject is neutralised in our main.
I'm sorry, Professor, I can't quite hear you there.
Oh, right. But can be fixed.
Okay, Professor Mark Logan, would you mind if I could move on to Dr. Cool, and then we'll come back to you so that we can sort out your sound. Thank you for your patience.
Sure.
Dr. Cool?
Hello, yeah, I was really just wanting to kind of echo what Karen said. Certainly in my experience, I was chatting to some of our fourth year computing students a couple of weeks ago who have been helping us in the lab doing some teaching with first year students, and they've been absolutely fantastic at it. They're great at kind of breaking down problems and explaining them to the first year students, but they had absolutely no idea that their course made them eligible to go and do a year's teacher training. So I wonder if there's maybe kind of more that the universities who offer that can do to help signpost that to universities across Scotland, whether it's about making sure that career departments and universities are able to, you know, push out that these courses exist and that, you know, all students on computing degrees would be eligible to apply. I think that would be really useful.
That's a really important point. Thank you, Natalie. I don't know if we're ready to go back to Mark. Yeah, we could try again. No, we're not ready to go back to Mark. I suppose I'm just sort of like trying to delve under it, getting a workforce. I mean, obviously, there's sort of, you know, every workforce is underrepresented by women, ethnic minorities. So what do you think could be done further to reach out into communities who maybe even more compounded don't consider computer science or digital tech skills as a career? Is it a case of within the educational professions? Is it at schools? Is it a government sort of campaign? Any ideas on that would be really welcome. Can I ask so Nicola? Nicola, you've not had a chance to say anything, so if you'd like to come in here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I think, to be honest, it's an element of everything that you've mentioned there. I think we need to start at the very beginning in our schools and allow, particularly girls, more of an opportunity to see the types of things that are available in our sector. I think we're running a critical friends programme just now, and the mantra behind it is you can't be what you can't see. So it's about exposing people to the positive role models in the industry and allowing them to see the types of things that are out there for them. I definitely think there's an awareness campaign that needs to be done on a larger level as well. And youth opportunities like the Digital Start Fund, which Skills Development Scotland are running, which allows you access into areas of deprivation, for example, which is a great way for us to be able to access demographics that we wouldn't normally look to target. And what we've established by running some of these initiatives is there is an untapped wealth of talent within these areas. We've had some success, particularly with a homeless chap who was able to undertake training at a very junior entry level through the Digital Start Fund. And actually, as a result of that, we've been able to secure him employment on the Isle of Skye in the sector.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's great. That's a really fascinating example. That's super. Is Mark Logan back on yet? If he is, just somebody let me know. Is there anyone else on the panel that wishes to come in on that? But I think Nicola did give quite a comprehensive answer to that. Oh, I think we're okay.
Can we have an update on Mark Logan's comms? Can we bring him in, or is he coming back in? He's coming back in. Okay. Because he's just rejoined. Mark, do you want to test your sound? Can we make out what you're saying?
Hi there. Can you hear me?
We can. That's much clearer. So, Kokab, would you like to resume your questioning on?
Yeah, I'm trying to. We sort of like moved on to try and get underneath the skin of it. I think my question was originally about the shortage of teachers and in computer science and digital skills, and the fact that the Scottish Government has committed substantial funds. So I'm interested in the impact of that. Is it just about money, or is it about other things? Why are people not coming forward to be computer teachers?
Yeah, I think it's more than money. I think it starts with our historical failure to recognise the importance of computing science to the economy. You know, if you think about our tech sector, it's one of the fastest growing parts of our economy. It has about 13,000 unfilled vacancies a year, and that's probably an underestimate. And the main supply line into that is essentially children that go on to become software engineers, and all the other jobs like product managers, marketeers, etc., are all a function of how many software engineers are in tech companies. So it's very important that we have a sufficient flow of young folks that want to go into that profession. If you look at how computing science is regarded in Scotland in the education system at school level, it's very far from being a peer of the other STEM subjects. In fact, it's very far from being a peer of geography or history and so on and so forth. It's essentially a third tier subject. And in the early years of secondary school, it vies for syllabus time with home economics and physical education. Now, because of that neglect, it's not a particularly attractive career prospect, hasn't got a great brand. In fact, teachers have been leaving the profession. We had about 20% more teachers 15 years ago doing computing science than we do now. And there's also a reduction in the number of children studying the subject. At higher level alone, for example, we used to have about 8,000 annually. We've now got about 5,000 annually. So the subject's not just static, it's declining. And I think the reason specifically we are not addressing the computing teacher recruitment issue is that we have put up reasons for why you can't hire computing graduates, so we shouldn't bother trying. And that reason is usually, well, computing science graduates can earn a lot of money in industry, so you know there's no point going after them. So when we talk about increasing teacher recruitment, that's true, but we don't have a strategy yet for how to tailor our efforts to attract people who want to become computing science teachers. So that's one of the many issues that we have in this space. But you know, I think that the root issue is that we haven't historically agreed that the subject matters. We don't believe the subject's in crisis, because if it doesn't matter, how could it be a crisis? Therefore, we haven't marshalled the action to address these things until recently, and we can talk perhaps later about what we're starting to do there. Just if I can also comment on the gender point, and I apologise for missing some of the earlier comments, the reason I think we have a gender problem in computing, in conjunction with many other societies, is that we have taken an extreme gender imbalance and considered it normal and acceptable, and that pervades our society. So the way we should look at this is that half of our best people are essentially excluded from an industry that we vitally depend on economically. So it's not enough to just, you look at ways we can get girls engaged in primary school, which I think we need to do. That's necessary, but it's not sufficient. We also have to recognise that when those girls look upwards, there are a few exemplars. And therefore, I think we've got to do more as a country on denormalising gender ghettoisation in the tech industry, which is a term I prefer, in the same way as we denormalised drunk driving some time back. I think we've got to use the same techniques, and we could again discuss that further. But my point here simply is it wouldn't be enough to have initiatives to get girls engaged if the industry as a whole has normalised these appalling gender divides.
Thanks, Mark. I'm happy to stop there, Convener. Thank you.
Professor Logan, Mark Logan, you produced the Logan Review. You are you're an authority in these areas. Part of the Logan Review suggested that computing science is actually a boring subject. The syllabus is not very exciting. You indicated in your review that the teachers tended to be generalists, and therefore there was an effect. I'll use the term, and it might be objectionable to some people, so I'm willing to be corrected, but a dumbing down in computer science, so that there was less about some of the more exciting aspects of computing science that required specialist knowledge and much more about the general. Well, how do we fix this then? Or how are we going about fixing this, and what can we do differently?
Yeah, so I think there's a number of things we can do, and I do think this problem is fixable. And I'd be happy to update the committee in my comments on what's now starting to happen in this area as part of my answer. And just to cover the issues you just mentioned from the ecosystem review report, essentially you can think of this as a vicious circle, or two vicious circles operating, and that's what we have to arrest. The first one is that as numbers fall, pupil numbers fall, classes don't get run, schools can't hire teachers, which in turn creates the impression that not so many teachers are needed, which in turn results in less pupils being involved. So that's one mechanism that's running. And the only way you address that is by very significantly fixing the recruitment issue, both in terms of attraction and also retention, because most of those issues are significant. The other issue, you know, which you referred to in your comments there, is a quality issue. Now, I think Karen certainly mentioned in her opening comments, and others may have done as well when I dropped off, that in many of our schools don't have any computing science being taught. But in many of our schools, and no one really knows how many, it's being taught by non-specialists, by, all credit to them, but well-intentioned, hard-working business studies teachers, psychology teachers, etc. And as an aside, I'll note that we wouldn't tolerate that with mathematics or physics, but we tolerate it in computing science, but it's a third-tier subject. Now, what that has the effect of doing is requiring the syllabus, and I use the term in my report, I hope it doesn't offend, but then again, I hope it gets the attention it needs, of a dumbing down of the syllabus. Non-specialists can't teach object-oriented programming, for example. So we have in the syllabus things like GDPR, and that's interesting to software engineers at professional level, not what we should be teaching our children. What we should be teaching them is the magic of getting computers to do stuff, and that requires a basic competence in our teaching profession in teaching programming, and that competence is patchy, let's say, so therefore the syllabus has to reflect that. Now, what can we do about this? I propose a number of things. I think the first thing is we need to launch an active recruitment campaign that doesn't accept that we can't recruit expensive computing science graduates. Now, I teach computing science undergraduates at fourth year, and I can tell you that a fair percentage of them don't want to become software engineers. They want to do something else with their degree. So there's a fertile field to hunt in if only we would approach them. Secondly, most science and engineering undergraduates are taught programming. So we could be approaching them from a recruitment perspective, for example. So we could look into that more, but that's a couple of examples. The second thing we need to do is we need to embark on a nationwide intensive ongoing upskilling campaign for our computing science teachers. And this is something that computing science particularly needs, because unlike, say, physics or mathematics, the subject changes more rapidly. So a teacher who graduated 12 years ago has never experienced app development. And those are the sort of projects that the kids want to be, doing, because that's what they think of as computing. So such a program needs to be put in place. I believe it could be put in place pretty quickly. The third thing we need to do is there's a morale problem amongst computing science teachers, because they know their profession is dying. And teachers don't feel like they're listened to in this. I've spoken to a lot of teachers, and that's what I hear. So the third thing we need to do, and we are doing this, is to set up a teacher-led body, recruit a couple of teachers full-time to it, to procure, curate, and promote best practice computing science teaching across Scotland. So that's the third thing we could do. Fourthly, we should be extending computing science teaching far more intensively into primary level, so we do engage pupils earlier. Many schools are teaching computing science only from third year, if at all. That's too late. I think also we need to be educating the country, parents, pupils, etc., that this subject actually leads to great career options and is a very interesting subject. So there's other things we should be doing beyond that, but these are what I would call the basic beginnings. Recently, as a result of the ecosystem review, Shilly-Ann Somerville, the Education Skills Cabinet Secretary, has convened a senior steering group of the CEOs of all the stakeholders, SDS, SFC, Education Scotland, etc., and including myself,
to take these areas I just mentioned and others and coordinate across the various stakeholders to start to get progress in those areas. So that's an encouraging development.
But when was that group convened and have they met yet? And when is the first meeting if it's not yet been held?
It was convened. Actually, the first meeting was just in the last 3 weeks, 2 to 3 weeks it happens. And since then, we have identified the first area we're going to work on, and we've identified a kind of frontline team who will work on these issues in a collaborative manner. The reason that that group is needed is because nobody owns this problem. You know, everybody owns a bit of education, a bit of computing science, so therefore nobody owns it. And my experiences in trying to address these issues the first time round, like over the last year, was again a kind of attitude of, that is a problem, good luck with that, you know, let us know when you've managed to get other people to agree that it's a problem. I call it the Wizard of Oz broomstick problem. Fetch me the broomstick and then we can talk. So the senior group's job is to overcome that mentality and to work collaboratively and direct our various agencies to actually affect change here. And I'm very encouraged that that group's been formed in the last month.
Okay, that's good. I'm going to bring in Michael Mara and then Stephanie Callaghan, and then we'll work our way around the table because everyone wants in on this. It's a hot topic.
So a supplementary on this, if that's okay, can be yes. I'll come back to my substantive question later on. That's great. I mean, I'm heartened by Professor Logan's comments, I think, in terms of a very practical shopping list of things that could happen now. And I think there's lots of nodding heads. If you can, you might not be able to see them, Professor Logan. That's the kind of thing we want to hear. We had the Shirley-Ann Somerville here with us on the 6th of October, and she told us some meetings were happening, but actually it didn't feel that there was a practical list of things that were taking place. We're 2 years on, I think, from the publication of the report that you authored. I mean, I'm detecting a certain frustration in terms of pace of change, in terms of bringing together these organisations. Is there more that we can be doing to this specific issue to push pace? What could we do usefully?
In August last year, but you're right. That, you know, my first sort of foray into this space, it was frustrating because I think the issues were, it wasn't considered an important issue in most of the agencies, or certainly not in the ones that had most influence on it, and therefore it wasn't considered worthy of urgent action. And also it was considered to be just a difficult thing to address because of multifunctional ownership. I think, you know, I'm very encouraged genuinely that under Shirley-Ann Somerville's sponsorship, we have this group set up and we've had very positive and energetic commitment from the various leaders of those agencies and groups to address this issue. So I think we are starting to address in order, is this important? Yes. Is it urgent that we take action? Yes, because we're declining when our competitors in Europe are strengthening in these areas. You know, our equivalent economies, equivalent sized countries like Estonia, Finland, Israel are, you know, miles ahead and getting further ahead in this issue. So I'm encouraged that that's well recognised now and actions required. I think to your question, Michael, about what else can we do? I think it's very important that we keep our attention span on this issue because this is going to be a multi-year fix. And I think what committees such as this can do is be helpful in reminding the various actors on this stage that, yes, it's important and, yes, it's urgent. Because I fear that with the kind of cut and thrust of life and, you know, education is a very complicated area generally, that this will start to fall back. And right now, I'd summarise it as what we need to do as a country is elevate computing science to be a peer of the other sciences. And as long as we haven't done that, there's work to be done. And we very much welcome support in keeping that goal front and centre.
From Stephanie Callaghan. Or maybe not.
Thank you, convener. Thank you. And thank you to the panel for coming along today. A question for Professor Logan, just round about this stuff here. I actually asked a question in Parliament of Shirley-Ann Somerville as well, just noting that Skills Development Scotland and the General Teaching Council for Scotland have noted the value of bringing computer experts into the classroom, naturally upskilling teachers and pupils together, you know, on issues like cyber security, etc. there. And I know that a number of partners are already working with schools to introduce industry skills. The Skills Development Scotland is quite heavily involved in supporting that work, and it's established a framework that brings agencies together to help them tackle that challenge. So really what I'm wondering, Professor Logan, is this an area that the working group, the senior steering group, will be focusing on, or that they should be focusing on going forward? Thanks.
Yeah, thank you for your question. So first of all, I agree it's a very important aspect to engage industry in the classroom for a number of reasons. One is it gives a concrete reason to learn the subject. You know, it gives pupils a sense of what does the future mean if I get interested in this subject. And secondly, it brings support and another type of upskilling to our teachers, which I think is very much appreciated. The reason I didn't mention it in our earlier list there is because there's already some really good things happening here. For example, you know, we have Scotland IS on the session this morning, and Scotland IS is running an excellent programme called Critical Friends, which brings industry folks into schools and pairs them. SDS is also team, which is starting to very well, and I understand both organisations are discussing how to, you know, work together rather than, you know, compete on those schemes, which is great to see. I think my concern previously is that, you know, we have a sort of a displacement mentality on this issue historically. The hard things, people see the hard things as hiring more teachers, keeping teachers, making the subject more interesting by introducing more project work and more extracurricular work. So no one really bothered fixing those things. They did the easy thing, and that's in relative terms, which is get industry engaged. So it's a very important element, but again, it's necessary and useful, but it's not sufficient. So if we only did that, we would make very little progress here. We do the industry work, which I think is fantastic, and I very much support it, in conjunction with those other things, then actually we're getting somewhere. So that's the kind of context for it.
I'm going to bring in Karen Meehan. At the mention of a digital critical friend, maybe, Karen, you would like to make some comments of your own in the area of questioning that Mark's been responding to.
No, absolutely. Thank you for that. What Mark had said is it's bringing industry into our schools to bring computing science and opportunities to the forefront for our young people, but it's also there to help upskill some of our teachers and support them, because we appreciate that, like I said earlier, they do their degree, they go into teaching, and most of them haven't actually had access to industry, so it brings in that industry-based practice to them. Again, they can't be what they can't see, as Nicola had said, so we're looking to have those e-figures, practitioners, not business leaders, the actual computing scientists, the software engineers, the data scientists, into our schools to highlight the subject. And we've had some success with that already. We just started the programme in August, rolling it out in Glasgow. And like Mark had said, it was in a school that did not have a computing science function, so it was being taught through a business module. They utilised the Critical Friends programme for that business model, and now a number of those pupils within that class are looking to take computing science in their third year of school. What industry can't do, and this is, as Mark said, it's not one thing that will fix everything. There are lots of initiatives that need to marry up for the bigger fix. But what the Critical Friends is doing just now is we're using industry to stimulate the curriculum, because they can't change it. So it's ways of making the curriculum exciting for teachers to teach, but also exciting for our young people to learn whilst in school. So, you know, when we look at industries, Mark said we have over 13,000 jobs go unfilled in this sector pre-pandemic. Given the digital transformation that's happened during the pandemic, that number is only set to rise. And I know SDS are doing some research on that just now. Our sector are coming to us as their industry trade body to say we need better coding skills, we need fundamental computing science, software engineering skills that we can then invest and harness
and nurture whilst they're in industry. We need to make sure that we're providing that talent pipeline, and that's got to start at schools. And it works all the way through, but it absolutely has to start at schools. And there's another piece around this upskilling of our current workforce. So I know that there are some graduates who, you know, we're saying there's this huge skills gap. There are some graduates who are not in our industry, have not been employed in there. And that's because for some of our SMEs, they've got this kind of mid-level practitioner, software engineer that they need to upskill to senior dev level. And some of that is just time in the sector, and we need to find a way to fast track that, because that's causing a bottleneck for our junior, you know, practitioners coming into the sector. So it's, you know, if there's three things we need to fix, it's education. We need to be promoting to our young people and their families and the people who are influencers in their life what our sector's like, where the opportunities are for our young people, and what it's really like to work in our sector. What does an ethical hacker do? What does a tester do? Because we're not getting those messages across, and we're not getting them across in first and second year, and then we're expecting them to take this as a core subject third, fourth and fifth year and on to further and higher education. So we absolutely need to get that part right. If we get that right, we get the teacher piece right. And I know we won't fix it all today, but collectively, you know, there has to be a bigger fundamental shift and fix for this.
Do you have any concerns about the supply of the kinds of teachers that Mark Logan has been describing that are not generalists, that are not fill-ins, but are actually specialists that can teach coding and all the other things that are exciting about computing science that currently are not being covered? Are you confident that there would be a supply of people in your sector, who are broadly in your sector, who would be willing to commit themselves to a career in teaching if all of the other conditions that Mark Logan and you've been describing were met?
Well, I think that's, you know, like I said earlier, teaching is a passion until you've tried it. So there's a huge piece of work around, I suppose, promoting that opportunity. There are a number of graduates, and Natalie's already mentioned, Mark's already speaking about the undergrads that they're teaching, who don't want to necessarily come into the sector, but we need to be signposting them as to what the other opportunities there are for them with their computing science degree, should it be that they don't want to come into this sector and work as software developers or, you know, computing scientists. And that's a piece of I suppose, work that collectively we have to do. And, you know, what Digital Critical Friends brings is some of those specialisms to teachers that are currently in our education sector just now. So, you know, I agree with Mark. Critical Friends programme, we think, is a wonderful programme. We're seeing progress. We're in 160 schools or so across Scotland, certainly by the turn of the year. We're seeing, you know, the case studies that we were getting from schools and teachers and industry, because ultimately what they're looking to do is develop that talent pipeline. Because, you know, and as part of the STEIR review, we have the Tech Scaler programme, which is great. The support for the SME community is great. But when we help them to grow and scale their business, where are we finding the talent to backfill that? And that's, you know, it's all part, it's closing off that circle that as a collective we need to look at.
Evidence had a lot in it about the gender imbalance, the gender ghettoisation of the sector that Mark Logan referred to. The Digital Critical Friends, how many of them are there and how many of them are women?
So of the Digital Critical Friends, we will be in 160 schools at the moment. We are recruiting for another two areas. So we probably got in the region of maybe just over 100 Digital Critical Friends from industry. I would say, Nicola, 20, 30 of them are female critical friends. So it's a good chunk. The problem hasn't been sorted. There is more that we need to do as a sector, but I can have a look at those figures and send them on to the committee, the exact figures of females.
It would be very helpful, because obviously, you know, we want to do everything we can to help and encourage in this area, because girls need to have role models, and you're right to focus on it. Ross Greer.
Thank you, Camille. Sticking with this point around the gender imbalance in STEM, I mean, I'm aware from a couple of studies that have been presented to this Parliament in evidence before that negative gender stereotypes, particularly around STEM and computing, are generally pretty embedded by the age of 7 or 8. And actually, one of the areas that it's tricky, but that we need to focus on is engagement with early years and primary school. So I'd be interested in the panel's thoughts on the extent to which engagement is actually happening, whether business in particular, but also embedded within the education system itself, whether that engagement is actually happening with early years and particularly with the primary 1 to 3 early primary school age group. Maybe I'd start with Karen on that one, if that's okay.
So there is various programmes in place. So you have Smart STEMs, which focuses on the, I suppose, the primary to very early secondary, again, pulling out that or promoting the sector and the skills requirements. And we've been a STEM ambassador with them in Scotland Is for a number of years now. We also have the Digital Extra Fund, which is a charity that Scotland Is and SDS set up 4 years ago, which again is supported by industry financially to roll out funds to organisations and schools and community groups to ensure that all of our children, regardless of their location or their economic background, have access to coding activity. Now, again, this has been supported by industry. They're the ones who are putting money in the pot for it to be distributed to various schools and community groups. So there are things going on. There's not enough. And some of the research that we've done a couple of years ago when we were allowed to speak to our young people and our primary kids when we were in the Smart STEMs programme was asking them, you know, why are they not looking at digital, or what is there something that's putting them off that potential career path? And actually, fundamentally, the results that came back were, no, I want to learn, but we only have one computer in the classroom, or we don't get, you know, the teacher doesn't do it every week or every month or every quarter. And they want to sit and make apps to help them and their classmates with their, you know, with their math. So the enthusiasm is absolutely there. But if we don't harness it at that young age, by the time we get to first and second year of school and we're teaching them Microsoft Office and portraying that as computing science, and then we're asking them to take it in higher education and then into industry, by that point, we've lost them. So this needs to go through the whole of our school years, absolutely. And I agree with Mark, it needs to be highlighted as a core subject. Every young person who will leave school from this day onwards will require some form of digital skills for any role that they're going to do. We're teaching our young people and our children, we're educating them for jobs of the future. We don't know what they are. Back in 2009, when we first highlighted the skills gap, we didn't have data scientists. You know, they weren't that. It wasn't an opportunity. No one knew position was there or that it was going to come. What are we going to be looking for in 10 years' time? What we don't want as a sector to be sat on committees like this in 10 years with the same issues, coming back to you saying we need to fix this. So, you know, I agree with Mark. It's fundamental and it needs to be fixed now. The industry need it to be fixed now.
Thanks very much. I'm very conscious of time, and there's another question I'd like to ask of Mark specifically. Would anyone else like to come in on this issue of engaging girls in particular at that very early primary school age? Slightly tricky because we can't actually see if anyone else is gesturing to come in. If anyone else is coming in, just start talking. Otherwise, I'll move on to Mark. Mark, you mentioned that the challenges of trying to keep the computing curriculum up to date, which, I mean, it's been 15 years now since I started high school, but I remember that even at that point, it was quite clear that the curriculum was quite dramatically out of date compared to the average level of digital literacy that an 11 or 12-year-old had. But part of the challenge there is around the digital divide that the pandemic has really highlighted, that was always there, but the pandemic's both highlighted and exacerbated. If we're to keep the curriculum up to date so that young people aren't bored in computing, how is that managed? If you're a computing teacher who has a class of 20, 25 young people, you could potentially have 20 of them who've got computers at schools, got their own iPads, got a smartphone. They've got a pretty high level of basic digital literacy, but you could have a handful or more who don't have a computer at home, who've never owned their own smartphone or a tablet, etc. How do we manage to both keep the curriculum up to date so that young people aren't bored being taught to do something that they learned years ago, but managing to keep every young person in the room engaged when there could actually be quite a wide spectrum of both digital literacy but access to digital devices in their own home as well?
Yeah, thank you, Ross. I think we need to ensure that there's not also a huge divide in the equipment available in our schools across Scotland, and right now there is. So I think the first thing to say on the curriculum is the curriculum is not homogenous. You know, there's an element of the curriculum which is basic logical computing pedagogy that doesn't change, and that should be at the core of what we teach. It's not today because, you know, the skills issues we talked about earlier on in teaching it, but that doesn't change very often. What changes is the projects that you then build, you know, the environment you build, demonstrate those basic fundamentals. And I think we've got to be very careful when we talk about changing the curriculum, because some data I've been looking at shows that every time we change the curriculum, we lose teachers from the profession. And the reason for that, I think, is because they're already apprehensive about their knowledge. And if you bring in a new concept, they've got to absorb that, learn how to teach it. This is too hard, I'm off. There's an element of that. And we've had a lot of curriculum change over the years, and we've lost a lot of teachers over the years at the same time. I don't know if they're causative, but I suspect that there's an element of that. So I'm advocating instead that we take things out of the curriculum. We take out that exam filler, that stuff that you put in there because you can ask questions on it, GDPR, for example. And instead, we create space for projects, and we ensure that our children have schools that are equipped with the sufficient kit that they can do those projects. And we ensure that schools have extracurricular programming clubs where they can continue to work on those projects if they want to do that. And I think those are relatively easy things to do. It doesn't cost a huge amount of money to address, but I think that makes an enormous difference to the problem. If I could make one comment, Ross, on your earlier question about gender, industry often waits for people to fix this problem. And I think that is the problem, because it's industry's fault as much as it's everyone else's fault. So if you think about a female director in a company, a tech director, she looks up at the board, and how many women does she see on that board that's a VP of engineering level? Not very many. Now let's look, so that discourages women from applying for that, because it's a hostile environment, and often it is, lots of subtle ways. Now let's look at the kind of mid-ranking engineer who looks up and doesn't see many engineering directors who are women. So that again sends a message. Then let's look at that young graduate who's thinking about becoming a programmer, but she doesn't see many team leaders and senior folks in those positions, so she doesn't consider that a career that's for her. Then you look at children in school considering doing a computing science degree, same thing. So you work it back, and that chain of a lack of exemplars means that even if you engage young girls at primary level in computing science, the society is telling them that it's a hostile career path, it's a hostile environment. And I think that's the thing we've got to fix. We've got to fix that context. And I'm fed up hearing industry people, complaining, like myself, I used to do, where I understood this issue better, about we'd hire more women if only we could get more kids interested at school level who are girls. At the same time, it's creating an environment that's essentially more difficult to progress in as a woman. So we've got to address that as much as we've got to address what's happening at schools.
Thanks very much. I'll leave it there, Convener.
Thank you very much, Ross. And for our final set of questions, Michael Mara.
Thanks, Convener.
Can I just, before Michael starts, I think, Mark Logan, we maybe only have you until about 12 o'clock. Is that right?
I've passed, and I apologise, but I can go for another 10 minutes.
Okay, that's very kind of you. Right, Michael Mara.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
I wanted to first direct my questions to Dr. Cool. You know, we've been talking about female leaders in the sector, and we've got one here, so I wanted to ask some questions. So I suppose, in first instance, my understanding of your own role, Dr. Cool, is that you would perhaps be at the interface of both the employers preparing graduates to go to work with companies, but also as one of the consumers of the exam system and people coming through. So I wonder if you can maybe start giving your reflection on the previous discussion, just in terms of what's coming out of our schools and of whether you feel people are being prepared for what you need to do in order to get them into those employment opportunities.
Is this, you know, specifically about gender or just more broadly in
more
terms
broad,
of...
More broadly about the kind of the system and skills. So if we park the gender issue just now, I think we've covered it quite comprehensively so far.
So certainly, you know, I echo what Mark was saying around, you know, computing science being perceived as a really kind of boring subject area. And I think it really is turning off so many kids. And one of the challenges that I see with this, you know, I've done a fair amount of outreach work through my role with local schools. And I've walked into a number of computing classrooms and found that the resources that they've got there are really just not fit for purpose. I've been in classrooms where it's taken the kids 20 minutes just to log in. And ultimately, that is then impacting on their perception of the subject area. And it's then been seen as boring. It doesn't work. This is not an environment where I feel invigorated and stimulated. One of the other things that I think computing teachers, even specialist computing teachers, really struggle with is, you know, they don't have admin rights, they don't have proper control over their own classrooms. I know myself teaching at university how catastrophic it can be if there's a software update that's been rolled out overnight and all of a sudden my practical doesn't work. Admin rights that teachers worked. So often, you know, I think IT staff support is available to teachers, but it's shared across an authority. So if a teacher has a problem in a classroom, they can't get that issue resolved during that class. And I think it really puts a lot of teachers off teaching those kind of more exciting aspects of computing because they're so practical. And it really depends on the technology being up to date and working effectively for them. And it just isn't there. It's not happening in our schools.
I think that's really useful in terms of the broader practical issues. You know, we focused, I think, in a very useful conversation on that 23% decline in the number of computing teachers, and we recognise something has to be done in that area. But that broader infrastructure, both human infrastructure in terms of support staff and around it, is particularly useful. I wonder if you could also, I'm conscious of, I suppose, the kind of the SQA role in this. You know, a lot of characterisation of this as a boring subject. One head teacher said to me very recently that this had been positioned where higher computing had become quite a technical, boring, accessible place, and actually rather than giving a sense of the inspiration and the possibility. Is that a characterisation that you would agree with and recognise?
Yeah, I think I would. And again, I agree with Mark's take on this, that perhaps assessing the subject predominantly through exams, again, just kind of promotes and encourages people to teach to the exam questions rather than really giving teachers that flexibility to introduce those kind of exciting projects where the kids can then develop that skills and get that kind of spark of, you know, innovation in terms of, wow, this could have, you know, implications for so many different things. I think it's certainly, it was a comment that I think it was Leon Thompson mentioned earlier that, you know, they see with the hospitality industry that, you know, the young people really don't understand the breadth of career opportunities that exist in hospitality. You know, their understanding of that subject area is very much limited to what they see around them in society. They'll go to restaurants, they understand front of house staff, chefs in the kitchen, but they don't appreciate the breadth of roles there. And I really see that in particular with computing. I had a conversation a few weeks ago with a six-year boy that I know, sort of friend of the family, who's really, really passionate about studying computing at university. But even though he's already got that passion, he had no idea the breadth of careers that exist there and computing's application in so many other subject areas. And I think that being able to help young people better understand the breadth of roles is also really key to addressing the gender balance. So we see all of the stereotypes out there around, you know, computing, it's geeky, you know, we see the IT crowd, it's all about people, you know, being kind of stuck in an office with no social skills and they just enjoy bashing away at a keyboard. And a lot of girls would perhaps be more interested in the subject area if they could see, okay, I can study this and then I can go and get a job that's helping, you know, with health informatics, that's perhaps looking at cancer treatments, that's really going to kind of make an impact. And there are genuinely rewarding careers here, and it's not just about you know, people with no social skills. And I think they really don't understand that how rewarding job opportunities in computing can actually be. And I really don't think that the curriculum helps kids to kind of see all of those rewarding careers. And I'm just kind of talking now, but certainly what Karen was saying, the critical friend as well, I think is really crucial to addressing that.
Thanks for that. And my final question relates, I think, to the your own institution. I recall speaking to a lecturer who had expressed frustration that the lack of young people taking higher computing had meant that for some of your core courses, you could no longer use it as a compulsory subject. And therefore, a lot of the teaching in first year was what would have been perhaps in through some of those areas. I mean, is that something that you see in common across other institutions that you're aware of as well as your own?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it was maybe 10 years ago now, maybe not as long as that, maybe 8 years ago now. So CICSA, so all of the institutions under CICSA, we agreed that we would not have higher computing as an entry requirement because it would then be a barrier to all of these children who just don't have that opportunity at school to study the subject area.
Okay. Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Dr. Cool.
Sobering comment to end our session on. It's been an excellent session, and all of you have brought a lot to wish we could have longer with this particular group of witnesses. I would particularly hope we could have you all back again, especially to talk about entrepreneurship in this context, because that was an area highlighted by the Logan Review, and it deserves further scrutiny by us. But can I thank Professor Mark Logan and Dr. Natalie Cool and Karen Meehan and Nicola Taylor for joining us this morning. Your time has been very valuable from your point of view, and it's been very well used from our point of view. So thank you for being with us. The public part of today's meeting is now at an end. I will now suspend the meeting. Can I ask members to reconvene on Microsoft Teams, which will allow us to consider our final agenda items in private. Thank you again to our witnesses, and have a very good day.